And am I calling you up or am I calling Jennifer? I'm calling both of you. Jennifer Gibson? All right. All right, I will do it at a break.
Good morning, libertarians.
Good morning, Nick.
It's 9:45, and the Libertarian National Convention will come back to order. First item on the agenda, the Credentials Committee report, Ms. Salvette.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've sent to the Secretary a list of names of voting members of the convention and their alternates who have been registered up until 9:12 this morning. There are 911 delegates, 76 alternates, for a total of 931 votes. Quorum equals 373. Majority is 466, two-thirds is 621, and seven-eighths is 815. Mr. Chairman, on behalf of the Credentials Committee, I move the revised roll of delegates submitted be the official roll of voting members of this convention.
All those in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. It carries.
Thank you. Additionally, we have had additions to the list from states, and the Credentials Committee has found these people eligible to vote. On behalf of the Credentials Committee, I move that Chad Carlton be added as a Missouri delegate, Emily Church as a Missouri alternate, Ashley Lewandowski as a Kansas delegate, and Marcus Lopez as a Nevada delegate.
It has been moved and seconded to add those names to the delegation list. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. They are added.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, delegate.
Are we good with ballots? Are we ready? Second. So I've been requested a point of information as far as the total number of delegates right now, people eligible to cast a vote with the additions that we made. Does the secretary have that? We'll be working on that point of information. I want to make a very quick announcement while the secretary is finding out about that point of information. The Georgia delegation has a very limited amount of 2016 commemorative lapel pins. They feature the Torch Eagle and the 2016 date. It's a limited print. There are only, I think, 200 of them in existence. They're available at the Georgia delegation, which is in the center, right in front of the camera row. 15 each, two for $25. Don't miss out. You can only get them here. updated number from the database of people credentialed and able to vote to answer the point of information is 997. All right, all. If you're in the halls, try and get to your delegation seats because there are some points of information at microphones. I'm going to start recognizing people at microphones when I can see the microphones, which is getting harder than it used to be. Microphone two, point of information.
In order to maintain quorum, what do delegates need to do when they leave?
I believe in order to maintain quorum, when delegates leave, they need to check out with the credentials desk. Is that correct? They need to check out with the credentials desk in order to keep our number accurate for people who are here.
Thank you.
So before you leave the convention, check out at the credentials desk. The next order of business for this convention is the election for President of the United States of America.
Point of privilege.
What was that?
Point of privilege.
Point of personal privilege, microphone number three.
At David Stewart of Oklahoma. We back in the back of the hall could not hear what you just said because of the noise from all the delegations. Could you repeat what you said, please?
I think so. Can we have a little bit of order? I believe I said the next order of business for this convention is the election, the nomination. No.
Prior to that.
When you're leaving convention, when you're actually going home, make sure to stop at the credentials desk and check out so that we do not lose quorum. So we will now proceed to a vote for the office of President of the United States.
Do you want delegation?
Point of order.
So the secretary is printing the ballots, and they are not printed yet. When they are printed, I will let you know, and then delegation chairs should approach the secretary's assistant desk to get the ballots.
Point of order.
Point of order, microphone two.
John Wilford, Texas. I thought it was brought up earlier that the parliamentarian had advised that we have no mechanism to check out for this convention. Is that correct?
I don't... Apparently, we can.
Okay.
Are there any other privilege motions? While we're waiting, is Rebecca Paddock in the room? Come on up, Ms. Paddock. I'd like to bring up Ms. Paddock from Texas to address you briefly for 2 minutes with your indulgence.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'm up here because I need your help. The Veterans Administration says that 22 vets a day commit suicide. That's an average. There is a peak during holidays, and this weekend is one of those holidays, Memorial Day. Memorial Day is set aside to remember those folks who gave their lives in service to this country. The vets that are alive today are spending this weekend thinking about their friends who died in their arms. It's a tough weekend for vets. Thank you. So this is where I need your help. This is a horrible weekend for vets. If you have friends that are vets, please take the time today and tomorrow to send them a text. Send them an email, give them a phone call, let them know you're thinking about them, and help me prevent suicide this Memorial Day weekend. No Suicides 2016. Thank you very much for your time and attention.
While the secretary is printing out the ballots, the AV people could bring up the Glendale video on the screen.
They got us in a trap.
In a trap.
They want to keep us in a trap.
They want to keep us in a trap.
Critical thinking.
Welcome to the Smoking Gun Apothecary, a unique spot on the planet. The first purpose-built dispensary in the world. And you'll see that it looks like a gun from space. This building not only sells recreational marijuana, it promotes the idea of the end of prohibition worldwide. Let's go in. You have just stepped into an environment that is like an old speakeasy. On these screens, we have a dedication to the sworn officers who've given their lives in the war of prohibition.
We have a lot of history, a lot of education here for the people that stop in that may not know the history of the prohibition and the war on drugs.
We're not just in a dispensary here, it's also an experience.
Before we enter into the speakeasy, you'll see a sign above the door that says something very interesting.
One of the things that we try to let our guests know when they come in, they are actually stepping back in time to 1870, which was 5 years before the first prohibition law actually went into effect. That was a time when people could actually order opium and heroin and have it delivered direct to their house. At that point in time, the U.S. addiction rate was only 1.5%.
So here we are, the Smoking Gun Apothecary. You look around the floor, that's called the Smoking Eagle. You notice you've got arrows in one hand and cannabis in the other. You look over here, replica jail cell, Mississippi, circa 1941. For what you're buying here today, you would have received a life sentence in Mississippi in 1941. Imagine putting people in jail for life, for a joint. So now we look at the Bank of Hibernia, 1870. These are the actual windows from the Bank of Hibernia. And why do we pick that? Because it was 5 years before the first drug law was passed.
The war on drugs is actually still a huge issue, and that's what most of our stuff is about. Like our mural behind me, just the whole theme of the place has to do with the war on drugs.
That fresco is the history of the drug war.
Besides product knowledge, we also give info on the war on drugs, and a lot of people don't know why it started, and it was just used to oppress a lot of minorities, and that it still is to this day, so that's why we're trying to do something different here and emphasize the war on drugs and how it needs to change.
So many nameless people have fought this war. Two of the most important that nobody's ever heard of were the first arrests made in the marijuana war. Meet Samuel Caldwell. Samuel sold two joints of marijuana to Moses Baca. For his effort, he got 24 months at hard labor. Moses Baca, little less, 18 months at hard labor in Leavenworth, Kansas. The prison sentence for Mr. Caldwell eventually killed him. He was never healthy when he got out of prison. Over here, my friend Wycliffe. Wycliffe ran for president of Haiti. One talented, interesting man. Our buddy Snoop. Looks like he'd have something to say to Mr. Anslinger if he could get his hands around his neck. We all know who this is, Willie. Willie will tell you today that all of his friends that were drinking lots of booze are gone. However, his friends that are smoking weed are still with us. There's lots of other people who fought this war and lost their lives as well. Right here, Billie Holiday, chained to a bed in Bellevue Hospital, lost her life. One of the greatest singers of all time. Peter McWilliams. Peter was dying of cancer and AIDS. Taking medication, the marijuana prevented him from becoming ill. Judge said he couldn't have it. He choked to death and drowned in a bathtub.
I actually lost my parents and my eldest sister to cancer. So part of my goal in coming out here to Denver was to learn more about the industry. I knew that there was a lot of very progressive treatments being done in the cannabis industry, and that was something that wasn't available to my family when they were suffering with cancer. So it definitely intrigued me to come out here and learn more about the industry and to find out what their options could have been had it been legalized there.
We can no longer tolerate the devastation that we are wreaking upon ourselves by electing the wrong people to positions of power. We want to change it. We make a decision to do that. We can start changing it right now. Send us your videos, send us your pieces, send us your stories. You can be a part of that. We'll all be a part of that. This screen is going to be dedicated to the video clips that get sent to us from around the world of the people who have been enmeshed in the drug war. Anybody that has a voice in this war will be on that screen. We've got to spread this word. We've got to tell everybody about it.
We are making history here. Like, this is huge, and I hope people realize that.
Stop prohibition, stop the insanity, and regain our liberty.
For critical times, government's not the answer. We need less of that. It's up to the people to take our country back. Cronies own the party. Corruption's everywhere. Clean it up for the love.
The Secretary has confirmed that ballots are available for the presidential election. State delegation chairs, please approach the Secretary's assistance table, stage left. Microphone two.
Los Leone, Texas.
Microphone two, please. Go ahead.
Ross Leone, Texas. May I make a very short announcement that it will be of interest to the body?
Go ahead.
My son, Ross III, has a petition on change.org, Let Liberty Debate, and I think it would be appropriate for the body to support that. So please check out Let Liberty Debate on change.org.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Van Gutierre and Jennifer Gibson to go to the left side of the stage whenever they have a chance to get up there. I also want to thank two libertarians this morning. This morning, a pedestrian was hit in a hit-and-run accident outside the hotel and was given medical assistance and first aid by Mr. Tim Moen and Dr. Marc Allan Feldman. Which just, it illustrates to me, we're libertarians because we love people. When you need help, find a libertarian. We're a lot more reliable than the government. I'd like to invite Mr. Gutierre up to the stage. He has some trash he needs to dispose of.
All right, guys, sorry, my fiance didn't want to come up here. She's stage fright. I'm a 13-day-old libertarian. I left the Republican Party for a reason. My fiance left the Republican Party for a reason. We will never go back. We will stay with this party. We will fight for this party, and we will win! This is my voter registration card for the Republican Party in Arizona, Legislative District 21. I am done with the Republican Party. There is no grand old party. This is the party. This is our party. We will win. Stand together, libertarians. Unite.
If anyone else has some unnecessary Republican or Democratic voter registration cards that they want to get rid of, please come see me after.
Mr. Chairman.
Microphone number three.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, there's probably many people out here watching on television who would like to know more about us. Can you tell the public how they can find out more about the Libertarian Party?
Absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Starr from California. If the American people want to find out more about a party that stands for all of your freedoms all of the time, they should visit lp.org or call 1-800-ELECT-US. I see the delegation chairs are gathering the ballots. I have something I want to read to you that's a little bit on a down note, and I just need to find it in my email. While we were gathered here in convention, a great libertarian from the state of Arizona, my delegation, Mr. Powell Gammel, passed away. See, you can't go with the yeah until you hear the rest of the sentence. Powell was a many-time candidate for the Libertarian Party of Arizona. He was a friend to the Arizona Libertarian Party. And if you will indulge me for just one moment, I will find my email from my state chair, Mr. Kielski, who's actually right in front of me. Powell Gammel took a fall at his home and passed away on Tuesday. He was an editor of freedomsphoenix.com, and his prior career was head of Arizona's state microbiology laboratory. He was a Libertarian candidate for Congress from Arizona in 2006, 2008, 2010, 2012, and 2014. During the 2012 campaign, during a televised debate, Powell gained fame for urging voters to not even vote, and then earning nearly 7% of the vote in a hotly contested three-way race, which exceeded the difference between the other candidates. In the 2014 election, the Democratic Party paid for mailers supporting Powell's run in a cynical, hypocritical, and ultimately misguided attempt to help their own candidate. In recent weeks, Powell had been excited about his upcoming run for Congress, because not only had he run in 2006, 2008, 2010, 2012, and 2014, he was going to run again in 2016. He was a good and honest man, and a great example of what it means to be a no-compromise libertarian. We will all miss his wit and charm on the campaign trail. Memorial service is scheduled June 5th in Scottsdale, Arizona. If we could all have a round of applause for the late Powell Gammel. I want to remind the delegation chairs that when they get their ballots and bring them back to their delegation, that they should let their tellers vote. The tellers do get to vote. Is Mr. Hayes in the room? He's somewhere in the room. Just a moment. This is your convention, so I want to ask, while we're balloting, with the indulgence of the body, I'd like to bring up somebody to speak for about 20 minutes. Is that okay with everybody? Sounds like mostly yes. He's moving towards the stage. I'd like to bring up a gentleman I had an opportunity to meet at Freedom Fest in 2014. He was kind enough to give me a copy of his book entitled Don't Hurt People and Don't Take Their Stuff. I've read it on the plane flying back and forth to Libertarian Party state conventions all around this country, and I've stolen the title for a lot of my interviews. Dr. Paco, do you have a privilege motion? Microphone two, very quickly.
Point of information.
Point of information, Dr. Paco.
Michael Paco from Arkansas. I notice on the ballots that none of the above is not listed as a candidate. I just wanted to ask the chair if NOTA is indeed a candidate.
None of the above is a candidate in every libertarian election ever.
Thank you, sir.
I hate to upstage him by mentioning none of the above, but I'd like to welcome to the stage Mr. Matt Kibbe.
Hi. My name's Matt, and I'm a recovering Republican. It took a lot of courage to come up here and admit that to you guys, but I feel like we're in a safe space, right? I'm feeling a little sensitive. I'm feeling like a snowflake. Frankly, I'm feeling a little bit used and abused, underappreciated, and I'm feeling kind of dirty about it now, you know? Because for years, I've worked within the Republican Party. I actually worked for the Republican National Committee. And every 2 years, every 4 years, you would start to get all of these calls and all of these letters. Eventually, you would get tweets and Facebook posts. And it sounded so awesome, right? Republicans love to talk about liberty. And they make all sorts of promises during the courtship process, right? And they'll tell you, honestly, this time, this time, we will defend the Constitution. This time, forget the last time, but this time, we're going to support your civil liberties and your freedom of speech and all of those values in the Bill of Rights that we talk about all the time when we're courting your vote. And you know it's not true. You know what they're up to. You know what they want, right? But you still do it. You probably had a couple drinks at this point. And you're thinking, you know, the future of this country is so important and liberty is so precious, and we're in such big trouble, the budget and the debt and the growing power of the state and the intrusions of the permanent imperial presidency. We got to do something, right? We got to do it. And at this point, you've had three cocktails, and they're telling you, no, really, this time I'm going to do it. So you do it, you know you shouldn't do it, but you do it anyway, and the next morning, you wake up next to Bob Dole. You roll over, and you realize, just like Groundhog Day, you wake up, and you realize you've done the same damn thing over and over again, hoping just maybe that this time it'll turn out different. But you know, it's no different. You wake up feeling dirty and used. It feels like a one-night stand because the day after the election, they never call. They don't write. All those Facebook posts stop. And all of a sudden, they're doing exactly what they did the last time you got drunk and voted Republican. Am I wrong? Are there any other recovering Republicans? So you guys know, it's safe. We're in a safe place. We can admit this now. I've been a libertarian my entire life. When I was 13 years old, I bought an album by this band called Rush. It was called 2112, and I'm of a certain age where you used to buy these things on this ancient thing called a record. Does anybody remember records? And back in the day, you would put that vinyl record on the album, on the player, and you would read the liner notes, and I was reading about this story about this abusive, authoritarian, benevolent dictatorship that was crushing the creative soul of someone that wanted to be free. And I made it to the bottom of the liner notes, and it says, what does it say? Dedicated to the genius of Ayn Rand. I was 13 years old. I didn't know who this dude Ayn Rand was. But I happened to see one of her books at a used garage sale. It was all banged up. It was a copy of Anthem. It was so old that Atlas Shrugged wasn't even listed as other books she had read. I read it, I devoured it, I sought out everything that Ayn Rand had read. It was difficult to do back in the day because we had these ancient institutions, they were called bookstores. And it was hard to find a book. It was particularly hard to find a book about liberty. But eventually, I read enough Ayn Rand that she dedicated and recommended Ludwig von Mises if you wanted to understand Austrian economics. At this point, I'm 16 years old, I'm reading Human Action, and it is the worst possible way in the world to meet girls, by the way. Chicks are not digging Ludwig von Mises when they're 16. By the way, that's changed. And eventually I went to Grove City College and I discovered by accident that there was a professor who had studied under Mises at Grove City called Hans Senholtz. And eventually I discovered that I was not the only libertarian in the entire universe, that there was perhaps dozens of us around the world. It was a revelation. Compare my accidental experience with liberty with young people today. If you want to know what libertarianism is today, you probably saw Ron Paul give a speech on YouTube, or maybe you're watching the LP convention and you Google it. You don't have to wait for your professor to tell you that liberty matters. You don't have to wait for three TV networks that used to tell you what to think to tell you that there was an alternative from the two-party duopoly, the Republicans and the Democrats, that constantly dictated from the top down what it is that we were allowed to believe, what it is we were allowed to stand for. Today, you can just Google it. And this is why we all speak of the libertarian moment. This is why things are different today in a fundamental way, because nobody gets to tell us what to believe anymore. If you are a young person today, you live in a radically libertarian world. You curate everything, you choose everything, you curate your friends, you choose your job. If you don't like your boss, you ditch him and you find another job online. If you don't like what mainstream media is telling you, you curate knowledge and information from multiple sources via your friends on Twitter. You choose everything. You even curate your institutions in a way that wasn't possible when I was a kid. This is why the Republican Party is collapsing before our very eyes. This is why a third party could be viable on the national stage for the first time in my lifetime. But let me suggest to you that the challenge we have as abused Republicans, as lifetime libertarians, as Liberty Party activists, is to understand just how big our potential community gets. We are no longer a cadre of people meeting in basements reading the footnotes from Human Action. We are now speaking to millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of eyeballs across all nations, across all government barriers, in a way that suggests, for the first time, liberty could be the majority in the United States. So here's what we got to do. We got to think about things a little bit differently. We have to appreciate that the political spectrum that you and I were taught in high school, you know, the one where on the far right you have fascism, which is nativist and authoritarian and a really bad thing. On the far left, you have socialism and communism, which is, according to your professor, wasn't nearly so bad. But eventually, this idea that the state would wither away was naive and hopeless. It felt better, but it wasn't so good. That spectrum never made sense to me, because in reality, all of those evil isms, fascism, socialism, communism, any form of authoritarianism, it all belongs on one side of the spectrum. And we have no better representations of that today than Republican Donald Trump and Democrat Hillary Clinton. Can we even tell the difference? But on the other side is liberty and community and people coming together to solve problems through voluntary cooperation and doing things that none of us could have done by ourselves all together. So my name is Matt, and I'm a Republican, but I'm thinking about this liberty thing. I'm thinking about the moment where we might come together as a community and appreciate that liberty is just not about freedom. Liberty is a responsibility that we all see when we look in the mirror in the morning. You're worried about the future of your country. You're worried that not enough people understand the threat of big government, the potential of freedom to solve problems. We got to come together in voluntary cooperation and do things that we've never done before. We have to do this because ultimately, I believe that all of us should be free as long as we don't hurt people or take their stuff. Thank you very much.
Can we have a round of applause for Matt Kibbe? Microphone two, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Nevada State Assemblyman John Moore. I'd like to thank the fine woman from Texas for bringing to light the alarming rate that our veterans are committing suicide. And a point of interest and a question for you, Mr. Chair. As we gather here and we're being covered by various national and international news outlets, the one thing that I do not see in this hall anywhere, where are the colors for our great country? Why are they not being displayed anywhere in this hall? That is a question for you, Mr. Chair.
I don't necessarily have a way to answer the gentleman's point of information. The Convention Oversight Committee has done the setup for the hall, and those were design decisions that I delegated out, and it is what it is.
Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone two.
I would like to make a motion to suspend the rules and
consider. Who are you? Identify yourself.
Rachel Mills from North Carolina.
Thank you.
Motion to suspend the rules to consider a resolution, please.
Okay. For 5 minutes?
For 5 minutes, yes.
Can you read your resolution? It has been brought to my attention. Point of order. It is not in order at this time. You have to wait for in between a vote.
Thank you.
Any other privilege motions, points of information?
Point of order, Mr.
Does everybody have the ballots? Do all state delegation chairs have their ballots at their states? If anyone doesn't, you have to come get it.
Daniel.
Okay, so they need to come up. Would the delegation chairs for South Dakota and Louisiana please go to the secretary's assistance desk to pick up the balloting packet?
Point of order?
There is a point of order at microphone number 3.
Okay, now it's working. Mr. Chair, isn't a motion to suspend the rules always in order?
Not during balloting. During the taking of a vote, it is not in order.
Delegation chairs, throughout the days you turn in tallies, make sure you write down a copy of the numbers that you turned in. When we display them on the screen for review, that gives you a way to double check that we have accurately recorded what you turned in. So please keep copies of all the numbers that you turn in. Thank you.
With the indulgence of the body, while we continue balloting, I'd like to bring up a candidate for Nevada State Senate District 7, Kimberly A. Shang, to address the delegates.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everybody's awake and excited. Like you said, Kimberly A. Shang from Nevada, running for a state senate. Now, when I was younger, say a few decades ago, I won't tell you how long that is because it is impolite to ask a lady her age. But I was a very introverted child. I couldn't wait to get home after marching band practice, to just open a book and listen to music. And eventually along the way came a great invention called Facebook. And for an introvert like me that didn't want to speak to people, Facebook was amazing. And one of the best things for politics is Facebook. So I would get on there and debate all the time. And at one point I became a Democrat who had one single issue, just like most of America. And I would fight for that issue. And one day I voted to get gay marriage. Because as a homosexual, I thought this was an issue I wanted to fight for. Eventually the Supreme Court gave me my right to marry. And then eventually, after I got that right, I didn't marry. And still am not married, and that's not an invitation. I'm just trying to make a point. I like that, don't do it, yes. I'm not ready to shackle myself just yet. But I realized that there was something missing, that the wars were still happening, we were still in debt, and there was a hollowness to that single issue. I got disillusioned, and I just didn't want to deal with politics anymore. Then one day I ran into a group of people that told me about libertarianism, and I realized, wow, it didn't actually matter what your position was or your issue. There was something about it. There was freedom, there was liberty, and all of a sudden I had something else to talk to you about on Facebook. And so I go around typing at everybody, all of my former Democrat friends, and then I found out that they didn't want freedom or liberty, and I was confused. Why would you want to be freed? Why don't you want liberty? And then I found out I was typing it to them, and that's the reason why they didn't understand. So I went to the Nevada Libertarian Party, and I said, I want to run as a state senator because I figured the best way to spread liberty and freedom is to actually enact legislation that would give the people freedom and liberty, because action is the best way to show people because you can tell them all day, you can type at them all you want about liberty, but they need to see it, they need to feel it. And for such an introverted person, who's becoming more of an extrovert now, I think, that I need to step out there. All of us need to step out. It doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what your background is. We all need to step out in some way, because at this point in time, I was much tired of talking. It's now time for action, and that is why I'm running for state senate in Nevada. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shang. I have a point of information that was given to me off of the floor. I'm aware that there is at least one delegation that is waiting to begin voting until the names of the candidates are shown on the screen. As a technical matter, that is not possible at this time. The secretary's screen is dedicated to tallying the ballots of the people who have turned them in, and so there's no way for me to have her laptop show the screen. So I would be happy to read the names, and I would ask the delegation chairs who need the names for their delegates to write them down. Does everyone have a pen and a paper? Good. First ballot for president has on it Dr. Marc Allan Feldman, Gary Johnson, John McAfee, Kevin McCormick, Darryl Perry, Austin Petersen. A space for write-ins, and though it has not been printed on the form, none of the above. Okay. I'd ask Mr. Kenneth Varley to find his delegation chair. He's a delegate from Arizona. Arizona is stage right. Point of microphone number two, please.
Yes, point of information from Trent Soames and Robert Clark of Pennsylvania.
Point of information, go ahead.
Is there a more efficient and secure way of voting than writing on index cards and turning them into a person?
Maybe. But this is the way we do it. Is blockchain a thing that works? Maybe we'll look into that for the next time.
Okay.
Microphone number one. Was there someone seeking to be recognized? No. Okay.
Not yet.
Are there any other points of information?
Yes, I have a point of information here. Microphone
point of information,
two.
Microphone two.
Bonnie Scott, Delegation Chair of Vermont. It was my understanding that NOTA was supposed to always be a choice
on
the ballot.
Wait, hold up. Order, please. I need to hear the woman from Vermont. Go ahead.
I haven't checked the bylaws, I'm sorry, but I thought it was my understanding that NOTA is always supposed to be a choice on the ballot.
None of the above is on your ballot, it just didn't get printed. So write it in. None of the above is an error in the ballot form, but we will accept votes for none of the above like we do in every election. Does that answer the gentlewoman's point of information?
The ladies, yes.
Time for
the ladies. Microphone number one.
Time for an announcement, Mr. Chair.
Yes, microphone one. Go ahead. Identify yourself first.
The Michigan delegation and the chair of Michigan expressly deny any belief that Ohio had hijacked that truck that was blocking from Michigan yesterday. We don't believe it. It may be true, but we don't believe it.
All right. I see microphone number four.
Nathan Grabo from the Colorado delegation. Point of information.
Point of information, sir. Go ahead.
Do we have to use the white note cards that we were given by the secretary, or can we use our own ballots if the delegation chair allows for it?
The delegation chair is allowed to use whatever balloting method the delegation chair chooses, but the ballot form that needs to be turned into the secretary is the yellow form that was distributed.
Thank you.
If the AV guys have, there's a picture that was provided to them of Dr. Feldman and Mr. Moen. If they can pop that up on the screen, I don't know whether or not they have it queued up yet. Microphone two, was there someone seeking to be recognized at microphone two? I guess not. Hey, look, libertarians helping somebody. If you want to go up and thank Dr. Feldman personally for helping out, he's right there, right behind Alabama. All right. Microphone number two.
Hi, I'm a delegate from Colorado, Nate Benson. I have a point of information.
Point of information, go ahead, sir.
I had a question. Will all the candidates, even the ones who don't reach the threshold, the minimum threshold, have their name read off or put on the screen at all?
They will not. The only candidates whose names I read out were the ones who met the threshold to have their name placed in nomination.
Okay, so Derek Grayson, T-Mott won't be listed there. Okay, thank you.
Was he a candidate for president or for vice president?
I voted for him.
What?
I voted for him. I nominated him.
So I don't, it'll be up to the secretary whether or not to count out write-ins. I believe we usually do.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right. Any other points of information or privileged motions?
Microphone number two, please.
Microphone number two, go ahead.
William McMillan from New York. Little bit of historical information that in my early conventions, the first one that I attended in 1979, the flags were not displayed on the stage. During the 80s and into the 90s, they were. And at one convention during the 1990s, I'm not sure whether it was 92 or 96, a delegate from California, Laura Stewart, pointed out that libertarians pledge allegiance to principles and not necessary to flags. So in all due respect to our veterans, I'd just like to make that statement.
Thank you for the point of information, sir. Microphone number one.
Hi, I'm Richard Lyon from Connecticut and running for Senate against Blumenthal. Thought you might like that. I have an announcement from the Libertarian Party of Connecticut. We have a couple bumper stickers we designed that we would like others to use so you can get them from us. One says legalizepotlp.org. The other says fight fire with water, vote libertarian. We're letting the Democrats and Republicans fight fire with fire. We're a little smarter than that. If you contact us, we'll find a way of hooking you up with some.
If you'd like to contact
Libertarian Party of Connecticut.
If you'd like to contact the Connecticut delegation, their stage center on the right hand.
We had them on our website, but we redid it and messed up. But we'll work that out. Thank you.
Can Mr. Hayes find his way to the right of my stage at some point? Are there any other points of information or announcements at this time? Without objection, while we're balloting, I would like to introduce the next governor of the state of Indiana, Mr. Rex Bell.
Greetings and salutations, fellow libertarians. It's a great honor to be up here. As Nick mentioned, I am the libertarian candidate for the great state of Indiana. I believe that this year we have the greatest opportunity ever to advance libertarianism because of all of these great people combined with the inability of the old parties to field any sane candidates. This isn't my first run. I've ran for office 7 times before, everywhere from county council to U.S. representative. I have received over 30% of the vote in many of those races, in two-way races. In 2010, I ran for the Indiana House of Representatives. I was able to garner nearly 21% of the vote in a three-way race against a Republican and a Democrat. Ballot Access News reported that that was the first time it had happened in 85 years. So I take a lot of pride in that, and it also gives me a lot of hope. It puts us just 13% away from a winning total in a three-way race. The three-way race I'm in this year contains a homophobe Republican and a wishy-washy Democrat. I think our chances are very good. While I was running for those offices, I was also the Wayne County Chair. While I was the Wayne County Chair, we have managed to win 8 races in Wayne County. These are partisan races where we elected Libertarians to office. My wife, Susan, sitting in the audience, has been elected to the Hagerstown Town Court Judge 4 times. We don't just do it once, we do it multi-times. I think you can see that we're not just messing around. We're very serious about this. My campaign committee has come up with a strategic plan. As frugal as they are, they say we need $100,000 to run an effective campaign. They told me my duty is to raise that money. So everybody please stay seated. But what I'd like to do is get one person to write me a check for $100,000. How simple would that be? Now, barring that, I would also accept $100 from 1,000 of you. I would accept $1,000 from 100 of you, or I would accept $10,000 from 10 of you. I'm very libertarian that way. I'm not stuck on any one single issue. I do believe I'm libertarian enough to accept anything from any of you that would like to contribute. You can go to electrexbell.com. There's a donate button there. You can find me on Facebook, Rex Bell for Governor. You can also go to stinkyshorts.com, which is a book that I wrote about libertarianism. It's normally $11.21. We have it on convention special for $10. I would appreciate any hope, any chance that you could give me, any help that you could give me this year. Appreciate you taking the time and listen, and let's get them this fall. Thank you.
Are there any other announcements, points of information? Microphone number 2.
Mr. Chair, the Hoosier delegate from Georgia would like to request that if anyone is aware of where the Georgia marker sign is, that it be returned right in front of the cameras.
Remember, kids, it's don't hurt people and don't take their stuff. Could the Wisconsin delegation chair please come to the secretary's assistance table, stage left?
I have a point of order, please.
Microphone number 2.
I know this was brought up already. This is Karen Ann Harlos from Colorado regarding NOTA not being on the printed tally sheets. I would like to know why this could not have been corrected, even handwritten. Isn't it required by our bylaws that NOTA always be on the tally sheet?
It is required, and in the interest of time, the ruling of the chair is that you just write NOTA in and count up the votes for NOTA so that we don't have to take the time to reprint ballots.
How would we feel if an actual named candidate was omitted from our tally sheet?
It'll be corrected for future ballots, Ms. Harlos.
Thank you.
While we continue this balloting process, does anyone have any objection if we bring Mr. Simmons, the Congress candidate from Massachusetts, back up? Because I didn't get a chance to really listen to his speech yesterday. Is that okay with everybody?
Mr. Chair?
Come on, Thomas Simmons.
It's all right.
thank you for letting me come back up here today. Massachusetts, as you know, if you were here yesterday, I'm running for Congress in the 1st District of Massachusetts, in Western Massachusetts. One thing we didn't get to talk about yesterday when I was up here, for 18 years, I have been a college professor of economics and business. For 18 years, my life has been trying to instill the principles of market economics into young minds coming into the classroom who come in not having a background in economics whatsoever. One of the issues we find, and if you speak to any teacher at the college level, they will confirm this. One of the issues we are constantly dealing with is that students enter our classroom and we make a reference to a historical event. We make a reference to a geographical location. We make a reference to a percent or a fraction. And we get a blank stare. And this has been happening and getting worse as I've been teaching as a teacher. Speaking to every one of these students as to why they did not come to college with the body of knowledge that every one of us takes for granted. Why they didn't learn this in school. And speaking to the teachers, you get the same exact answer all the time. They didn't teach us that because we had to teach to the test. We had to learn how to take standardized tests. We didn't learn how to think. We learned how to fill in a bubble answer. Is it A, B, C, or D? No Child Left Behind started this nonsense. The current effort to tie school funding, where the federal government takes your taxes and then dangles it back to you at the state level and says, if you take the right standardized test and you do well, you'll get your money back, has destroyed and is continuing to destroy public education in the United States. The federal government has no role in telling states and school districts what to teach, how to teach it, and to hold money ransom so that teachers' hands are tied and students are learning to fill bubbles and take tests instead of learning how to think critically. My opponent, Richard Neal, the incumbent for 26 years, is one of the strongest proponents of holding federal money hostage to standardized tests. As a teacher for 18 years, I will tell you this has got to stop. And when I defeat him, the first thing I will seek to do is end Common Core in this country.
Thank you, Mr. Simmons. Are there any other points of information or people seeking to be recognized at this time? Microphone number one.
Point of personal privilege.
Point of personal privilege, microphone one.
This country and this party loves music. We don't have a theme song. There's an old fiddle tune, and the name of that tune is Liberty. So I'm going to play it for you. If you like it, maybe we can adopt this as a semi-official tune.
Go ahead, sir. Thank you, sir. I wish all privileged motions were that entertaining. If there are delegations that have not submitted their vote to the secretary, please work on getting those in as soon as possible. The faster we turn them in, the faster we count them. The faster we count them, the faster we announce them. The faster we announce them, the faster we get to work on electing a Libertarian president.